right, once again, welcome. We are continuing in our series called James. When you came in, you received some notes as well, and we're just going to kind of jump into it today and kind of continue on that series. We started it last week, and what we're doing is we're kind of going section by section through the letter that James wrote in the New Testament, and this is what we would call a summer series. And so in the summer, what we like to do is just kind of dig deep and kind of build and grow you. And so it's really all about health, and it's about growing. And so what we're doing is we're going to jump in and kind of follow along this whole letter of James. Usually we do series, and when we do series, a lot of times they're topic-based. Kind of like, here's a thought that we want to kind of communicate over a few weeks' time, and then we go and we find scripture verses that kind of support that, and we build the series kind of that way. What we're doing this time is we're just taking the book of James and going through it. And we're letting James be the point. We're like letting what he writes in the scripture verse be the point. So everything we talk about is coming straight out of the book of James. And I love James. It's really my favorite book in the New Testament. And I don't know if it's the northerner in me, it's just my personality or whatever. It's just straightforward. It's kind of straight fire, kind of punch you in the gut sometimes, step on your toes a little bit, push you around a little bit, and sometimes even feels a little bit harsh. But the beauty of James is even with all that harshness, there's always hope built into it. There's always some reason why it is that he's saying what he's saying. And so even though it's really straightforward and it gets straight to the point, more so really than any other book in the New Testament, it's just kind of this beautiful revelation of how it is that we're supposed to live. And the reason why James is writing it, just to kind of give you some context, in case you weren't here last week to talk about that context, out the gate he gives the shortest greeting, and some say he doesn't even kind of conclude. I think there's a small conclusion there. But he gives the shortest greeting of all the letters because he's just trying to get to his point. And the reason why is we're talking about James. He's the brother of Jesus, not the disciple James. This is the half-brother of Jesus who, when Jesus was living, wasn't even a follower. He didn't believe that Jesus was the Son of God, which as his brother, I can kind of understand that, right? Like, I have two brothers. I don't know what I would have to do to be able to convince my brothers that I'm God. Like, think about that for a second. Could you convince your siblings that you're God? That'd be kind of tough. And it must have been tough growing up with Jesus. I mean, think about it for a second. If you grew up with your brother as Jesus, like, how many of you have a sibling? Well, you don't have to raise your hand, but you have a sibling that you already feel like your parents think they're God, right? Like, they walk on water. Jesus did walk on water. He was God. Can you imagine growing up in the same house and having that be the brother you're compared to? Because Jesus was the oldest, too. So you talk about growing up in someone's shadow. If you're James, that's tough. Like, James had a hard life, if you think about it that way. And so he didn't even believe at first. And the Bible's very clear about that. He didn't believe that Jesus was who he said he was or that he could do what he said he could do until after the resurrection. And after the resurrection, I believe it's Corinthians that records that James comes to follow Jesus. He understands that his brother is who his mother claimed he was the whole time. Like, I can't imagine my two brothers, if my mom claimed one of them was God, of the resentment that I would live with. And so it wasn't until after Jesus dies and then is resurrected that James finally believes. And this interesting thing happens. He doesn't just become a follower. He becomes really the first pastor. And so he's kind of the standard, right? So he's the first pastor in the church of Jerusalem. So his responsibility are all these new Christians. Everybody's a new Christian. Every single person in the church, they're all baby Christians. They're all people who have been converted into Christianity somehow. So Peter gets up and he preaches the first gospel message on the day of Pentecost and 3,000 people get saved. And so we know 3,000 people get saved here, another time 3,000, another time 4,000 people. So these thousands of people living in Jerusalem get saved, and James is their pastor. And they're meeting in their homes, and they're going to the temple, and his responsibility is the spiritual well-being of all of those people. Well, before Jesus went back to heaven, he gave this mandate to his disciples. He said, go into all the world and preach the gospel, in Jerusalem and in Judea and the outermost parts of the world. They didn't do that. They kind of disobeyed. They stayed in Jerusalem. Think about Jerusalem as like it's this safe haven for those who believe. Because Jerusalem is like, it's already so ingrained in religion. The whole society, everything is based on religion. And so it's like this hyper-spiritual bubble that they were all living in. So life was good in Jerusalem. And so they didn't want to leave Jerusalem. They stayed right there, just kept worshiping James as their pastor. And so God, because he wants them to spread, he brings in what's called this great persecution that happens. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, persecution starts. We know that Saul, who later became Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament, he was kind of the leader of that. He comes in, there's the first martyr, he kills somebody. They lay their garments at Saul's feet before he becomes Paul. And then he says, hey, this is a good way for me to get rich and famous. I can climb the church ranks this way. So he starts to persecute Christians. And now Christians are being killed, they're being thrown in prison, they're being beaten, they're being, kicked out of their homes. Terrible things are happening. So what has to happen? They have to scatter. They have to leave Jerusalem. So God allows this to happen to push them out. And they scatter and leave Jerusalem. And so what we have in the letter of James is we have their pastor, as they're all leaving to go live in these other cities, this is kind of like his one last shot. This is his big sermon where he can throw everything in, including the kitchen sink, to get across to them what he needs to get across to them. And so James has no room for pleasantries. So there's not a big greeting because he doesn't have time for that. He's talking to his people that are scattered, and he's trying to say, okay, you have to now survive in a world out there that isn't this religious bubble that Jerusalem is. Now you're living in Greek and Roman cities. You've got to go out there into a pagan world, and you've got to somehow survive. I'm going to give you everything I can, like fire hose style at once. And I love the book of James, I think, for that. And so it's so straightforward. There's not a whole lot of doctrine. There's not a whole lot of anything but just straight wisdom and practical kind of things for you to do and for me to do. The beauty of it is, here's how I think it relates to us in so many ways. Although, no, we haven't been persecuted and forced out of our cities, we live in a pagan world, do we not? Like, that's not a safe place out there for Christians anymore. Like, we come into church, and it's really easy to be a good Christian in church on Sundays. But all of us are going to scatter this afternoon. And we're going to go to wherever we are, in whatever suburb or wherever we live in this city, and now we're on our own to make it through the week. So what James is giving us here today is practical principles that will help you survive out there, to help you be godly and to help you change the world around you. And that's what this is for us. It's what it was for them. Okay, so we're in the second kind of section here of just straight fire James. And so we're going to jump in. And I've got notes there if you want to follow along and kind of fill in the blanks a little bit. I'm going to read the whole passage, and then we'll go back and start breaking stuff down. Okay, so James chapter 1, we're going to read verses 19 all the way through 27. Understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. You must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. Human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. So get rid of all the filth and evil in your lives and humbly accept the word God has planted in your hearts, for it has the power to save your souls. But don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you are only fooling yourselves. For if you listen to the word and don't obey it, it is like glancing at your face in a mirror. You see yourself, walk away, and forget what you look like. But if you look carefully into the perfect law that sets you free, and if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard, then God will bless you for doing it. If you claim to be religious but don't control your tongue, you are fooling yourself. And if your religion is worthless, pure and genuine religion in the sight of God the Father means caring for orphans and widows in their distress and refusing to let the world corrupt you. Let's pray real quick and just ask God to bless his word today. Father, we just thank you so much for the opportunity to be in your house today. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to study your word together. And so today we just ask that you would reveal to us what it is that you would like us to learn, that you would make your word come alive to us today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So he feels like he kind of jumps into several topics there, but that's kind of at a first kind of cursory glance. But in reality, he's really kind of talking about one thing kind of straight through. So you got to remember, he's talking to people who have scattered. In our first section, we talked about trials and temptations because it was a major trial, a testing of them as they're being persecuted. Now temptation is they're entering a world that isn't Jewish. They're entering into cities like Corinth and some of those other cities which were known for their depravity. And so there's all kinds of temptation happening. And now James says, okay, so here's how you kind of solidify all that. Like, there's a way that you have to anchor your life. You're no longer here in this safe place in Jerusalem. And so for us here today, once you leave this place, you're no longer in this safe spiritual kind of bubble that is the church. So how do you anchor yourself? What do you anchor yourself to so that you can go into the world and you can live the kind of godly life that we're talking about? Now, many of us, we kind of call this passage listening and doing, or the practice of the word. And the whole idea is this, is that the word was given to you by God. It is God, right? The word was made flesh. So Jesus, but the word was given to us so that we can anchor our lives to it, that there's things there for us to do with it. And so the whole overarching main idea is this, is that it's not just good enough to come to church on Sundays and hear someone preach the word. That if you don't take it and apply it to your lives, then it means nothing when you go out there. It does nothing for you. And so let's just kind of talk about that for a few minutes. Really what we're talking about here is the word of God. And so James kind of gives us three simple things, just three simple things when it comes to the word of God in our lives. Like as we leave this spiritual bubble and we go out there into the world, we've got to anchor ourselves to something. That thing should be the word of God, by the way, which never changes. That's why we should anchor ourselves to it. Anchor yourselves to something. And so how do we allow the word to produce in our lives the things that it's supposed to produce? How does it make a difference in our lives? And he kind of gives us three simple, easy steps. And so we're just going to jump right into it. The very first thing is this, is that you need to hear the word of God. That if you're going to scatter and go out into the world, and you're going to maintain godliness, and you're going to be the person that God called you to be, you need to put yourselves in situations where you get to hear God's word. Like, you need to hear it. You need to listen to it. Be, be quick to listen, be slow to speak. And so he's talking to all these churches that are establishing out there, brand new churches, just like ours. Be quick to listen, be slow to speak. The idea is you need to put yourself in a position where you can hear the word of God. Now, God speaks to us in kind of many ways. I don't know about you, but he speaks to me in different ways at different times in my life. One way is the word of God itself. We have the Bible. You come to church and you hear someone proclaim the word of God, what I'm doing right now. That's one way to hear the word of God. Small groups are a good place to hear the word of God. You can go out and get into small groups, Bible studies, things like that. In your own reading time, in your own praying time, there's all kinds of ways that we can learn and hear the word of God. The point is just this. However you do it, you need to do it. You need to do it regularly. Matter of fact, you should probably incorporate all of those things into your life. You need to put yourself in a position where you get to hear the word of God. That means be in church every time you can be in church. That means get into a small group. It means get into the word on your own as well. And I know it's not always the easiest thing to sometimes read through the Bible and say, okay, I don't really understand that. But God's number one way of speaking to us is this word right here. Oftentimes people come to me and they'll say something like, well, God never speaks to me. Right? Because we read the Bible and we hear stories and, like, you know, the skies split and the audible voice of God speaks over Jesus at one point. We know that he speaks through dreams and visions, right? There's supposed to be that little whisper sometimes in the back of our head somewhere behind our ear. And people often come to me and say, well, I never hear God speaking to me. And my first question is always, when was the last time you read his word? Because the Bible tells us that of itself, it is the living, breathing word of God. It is never changing. It is his word to us. That's why we have it. And so anytime someone says to me, I just haven't heard the word, you know, God doesn't speak to me. That's because we're not in here enough. Why would God split the sky and speak to you if he can't get you to split the book and read his word? Like, that's where he starts. That's where he begins when he speaks to us. And so you've got to get into the word of God. So you have to put yourself in a position where you can actually hear what it is that he's wanting to say. I saw an interesting stat. George Barna, maybe you've heard of him, maybe you haven't. He writes books. But he's kind of this Christian, like, pollster, I guess. He does these polls, he does these surveys, and he's really good at what he does. He's not always good at his conclusions, but that's for another time and place. But he's really good at what he does. And so he likes to survey these things. And so he surveys the church, he surveys the world, he kind of always finds out these things. And he did a survey here in America, and what he found was that 37% of all Christians claim to read the Bible at least once a week. So 37% of all Christians get into the word at least once a week. The same exact study showed us that 80% of Christians claim to pray once a week. I find that very interesting. 80% pray at least once a week. Only 37% read once a week. So what does that tell us? This is what it tells me. We like to talk a whole lot more than we like to listen. Right? Like, we love talking to God. I don't think we always love listening to God. And so I don't know what your prayer time looks like. If I'm not careful, my prayer time looks like this. God, thank you for this day and all the things that you have given me. Here's what I need, and here's what I'm looking for, and here's what I want, and here's what I want for my kids, and here's what I want for my family, and here's what I want for my church, and here's what I want for my wife, and here's what I want for my career, and here's what I want. Lord, I need you to do all these things for me. Good. All right, let's go. Like, I can pray everything I want to pray in like 30 seconds. I don't know about you, but that's how it gets for me. And if I go more than that, sometimes I find myself drifting or wandering off, or I'm over here and I'm over there. But most of the time, it's just like, Lord, here's the things I need. Like, let me just tell you some things, God. Sometimes I'm angry at God, and then I really want to talk to him, right? And so we communicate to God really well. Most of us do a good job of that, communicating to him. I think where we fail oftentimes is that a conversation is actually supposed to go two ways. Like, in your prayer time, you should build in time for God to speak to you as well. There should be some time where you're not talking in your prayer time. And really, that's what the word is for, too. It's a chance for you to sit down and simply listen to what it is that God has to say for you. Not just to overhear it, but to truly listen. Like, it's an active word, listening. And so we need to hear the word of God. We need to put ourselves in a position where God can speak to us, because it's a crazy world out there. And if we can't hear his voice in that crazy world out there, we tend to go crazy with it. I think all of us would agree with that. And so we have to put ourselves in a place where we hear God's word, church, the Bible, small groups, get around friends, read it for ourselves, spend time praying for ourselves. So he says you got to anchor yourself to something. That thing is the word. And so you got to put yourself in a place to hear the word. The second thing he says is that you need to put yourself in a place where you accept God's word. You have to accept what it's saying to you. This is something we talk about in Growth Track, the idea of accepting the authority of the word, accepting what God has to say to you. Oftentimes, we love to hear the word of God, but we have a hard time accepting it for ourselves. Because I promise you this, just like when you read through James, not everything God has to say to you is lovey-dovey and easy and good. Sometimes he's going to ask something of you that you may not want to do. He's going to ask you to give up something you may not want to give up. There's times when he speaks into your life and you don't want to listen to it. And so you have to go in knowing that you're willing to accept what it is that God has to say to you. Accept the word, because it can't do anything for you if you can't accept it. So you got to accept the authority of the word. That's the thing we talk about in Growth Track, accepting the authority of the word. If God spoke it, it should have authority in my life. And if it has authority in my life, then I should do what it tells me to do. And I think we really struggle with authority oftentimes. Like, authority isn't an easy thing for us anymore, because we've had so many people in authority that have screwed up along the way, and they've messed up. Why? Because they're human beings. Like, somehow we're allowed to mess up, but we can't. People in authority can't mess up, and so we hold them to a different standard. Now, there's a responsibility that comes with authority. But we have to accept the authority of the word in our lives. Number one, because if we're not going to do what it tells us to do, it's not going to make a difference in our life if we can't accept it. Because he's going to ask us to do some things that we don't want to do, or he's going to point some things out we don't want him to point out. He's going to show us some things that we don't want him to show us. So we have to accept it, and knowing we're accepting it going in. We also have to know that we believe everything that the word says, right? Like, accepting the authority of the word means, like, no matter what it says, I believe it to be true as well. The example that I like to give in Growth Track is, I did a series one time on the book of Jonah. And so we were talking through Jonah. Now, Jonah's kind of a weird story. We're talking about a guy who doesn't do what God asks him to do. He's a prophet, which means his job is to speak what God wants him to his generation. And so God says, hey, I need you to go over to that city over there, and I need you to speak to them for me. And you need to tell them this. And if they'll do what it is that you say, then I'm going to spare the city. If not, I'm going to destroy the city. Well, Jonah has obviously something against that city. Now, that city was full of Syrians, which were one of the cruelest peoples to ever live on the face of the planet. And that's for another series. We can talk about some of the things that happened. But Jonah didn't want the city to be spared. He actually thought it would be best if God did destroy the city. So he had his own ideas that he didn't want to hear, that God was going to save the city. So Jonah decides to go in the opposite direction instead of heading towards the city. And along the way, he ends up on a boat, and now he's out to sea, and he's sailing, and God finds him out there too, causes a big storm. They throw him overboard, and long story short, a fish eats Jonah. And 3 days later, spits him up on the shore so that he can then get up and walk to Nineveh to tell them the story that God tells him to tell. Now, we're talking about a fish eating someone. And 3 days later, spitting him up on the sand, and he's still alive. That's a little fishy to me, right? Like, that. Okay, can that actually happen? Like, is that a real thing? So as I'm approaching this series that I want to do on the book of Jonah, I have to ask myself, do I believe that this could even happen? Like, do I believe that a fish could eat a man and spit him up on the sand 3 days later, and he's still alive and fully functioning and can now walk to the city and preach to them? I have to be able to believe that if I'm going to allow the story to teach me anything, right? So we have to bring ourselves to a place where we know we can believe that. And so what I did was I started doing some study. And so I said, okay, can a man survive being eaten by a fish? And there are actual stories out there. There's a story from the Boston Globe. Listen to this. Story that was in the Boston Globe back when we had whaling, right? So there's a ship that went out. They were trying to catch a whale. Whaling's very dangerous. Man goes overboard. The whale eats him. They kill the whale, put it on the ship, and haul it back to Boston. 2 days later, they cut the whale open, and the man's still alive in his stomach. It's pretty interesting. Kind of a weird story. Still alive. Now, that's one of our newspapers recording that as a thing that's actually happened in somewhat recent history. And so I have to say to myself, well, okay, maybe I can believe. But the reality is, when I got to thinking about it, I don't need a story in a newspaper to tell me that a man could be eaten by a fish and survive for 3 days. Because the whole basis of my religion, right, the whole basis of this thing called Christianity is that a virgin gave birth, first of all, that doesn't happen, to the Son of God, who was fully God and fully man at the same time. He lived a perfect life, was crucified on a cross, buried in the ground, and 3 days later got back up. If I can believe all that happened and base my entire life on that, then I can believe that a fish can eat a man, spin him up on the ground 3 days later if God deems it to be so, right? Does that make sense? So we have to accept the authority of God's word into our life. We have to accept, put ourselves in a position where we know we accept what he's going to say. Because I guarantee you he's going to ask something of you that you don't want to give up. Or he's going to point something out that you don't really want pointed out. And so you've got to accept the word of God. That's why James says accept what he's put into your heart so that he can bless you. Because until you really accept it and apply it to your life, there's not much blessing that he can do in your life until you come to that place. So we need to hear the word of God. So let's not just talk to God. Let's listen to what he says as well. Let's accept what he says in our lives, even when it's tough. And the third thing is this, is quite simple, is we need to do the word of God. Like, there actually comes the place where you have to actually live it out. That I can sit down to a big, beautiful steak dinner, and until I actually put it in my mouth, chew it up, and swallow it, it doesn't do me any good. And that's kind of what the word is. It's like this platter that's been laid out in front of us. And as long as we just look at it, we're going to stay hungry. As long as you just look at it, it's not going to do you any good. You can starve to death staring at the Bible. You've got to actually take it and implement it into your life. You actually have to do the thing that it asks you to do. You have to put it to work. In fact, James says it this way. I find it very interesting. He says, don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you're only fooling yourselves. For if you listen to the word and don't obey it, it is like glancing at your face in a mirror. You see yourself and then walk away and forget what you look like. But if you look carefully into the perfect law, so he's talking about the Bible here as a mirror, that sets you free. And if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard, then God will bless you for doing it. So he says it's kind of like looking into a mirror. I brought a mirror with me today. Kind of this little mirror thing that my wife has. And so he's saying it's kind of like looking into a mirror, right? Like you look in, you know you look good, right? You know you do, right? You ever been to the restaurant and you're sitting down with people, like maybe friends, or maybe it's a business meeting, right? It's people you want to impress, so you look nice, take them to a nice place, sit down, you're having a nice meal. You excuse yourself to go to the bathroom. Of course, you check yourself in the mirror, right? Nobody goes in and doesn't check themselves in the mirror. We're vain people. We love the mirror. So you check yourself in the mirror and you smile, right? You smile at yourself because you know you look good. And then when you smile at yourself, you realize you're eating broccoli, right? Anyone ever been there before? And this big honking piece of broccoli between your teeth, like it's just glowing, it's shining. Like it's like, you can't see it with your mouth closed, but as soon as you talk, you can see it. Would it not be foolish of you to go into the bathroom, look at yourself and know that you look good? Yeah, I look good. See, for me, I'd have to fix my hair, because imaginary Jay has Pastor Jacob's hair. Right? Imaginary Jay does, right? Right? So I got to fix my hair. I know that looks good. I know I look good, right? Then I smile and see the broccoli. How foolish would you look if you said, oh, man, there's a piece of broccoli there. Oh, well. And you just went right back out, sat down, and kept on talking and didn't pick the thing out. Like, how ridiculous would that be, right? Or if you went into the hair and saw your hair was all messed up, and instead of fixing your hair, you just went back out, forgot completely about it, sat down to dinner, and just finished your nice dinner with your boss and his wife or whatever it is. Like, how foolish would it be if you did that? What James is saying is it's even more foolish when you look into God's perfect law, his word, which is a mirror which reflects back at you everything that God has for you and who it is that he created you to be. See, when you look into the word, it is a mirror that reflects back at you the you that he created you to be. And so how foolish is it for you to look into God's perfect word, which reflects back to you the person he created you to be, to see the flaws that are there and then to walk away as if they weren't? It's just as foolish to look into your spiritual mirror and do nothing to fix what's going on as it is to look into the mirror at the bathroom and leave the chunk of broccoli in your teeth. It's the same thing. It's just as foolish. So he says you can't just listen to the word. You can't just come to church and go back out and live the way that you want to live when you're out there. You've got to do what it says. I find it very strange in our present society, this culture that we've built, where what most of us do now is we allow our lifestyles to dictate our beliefs instead of allowing our beliefs to dictate our lifestyle. See, there was a time with your parents and your grandparents where if they believed it to be true, then they lived that way. So if the Bible told me this, then I must live this way. And it seems like this shift has happened in the church and this shift has happened in America, where now we live the way we want to live and then we impose that lifestyle onto God's word. Well, I don't think he really meant that, at least not for me. And so we impose that on him. And so instead of living according to our beliefs, we live according to our lifestyle and make our beliefs line up with our lifestyle. The problem with that is that if your belief system is founded in something that doesn't change, then you'll always have an anchor to anchor yourself to. But if your entire belief system is based on your lifestyle, the way that you feel like you should live, your entire belief system can't be anchored to anything. Your life can't be anchored because it will shift with the wind. It's what James was talking about in the last passage, being tossed about by the wind and the waves. That as soon as you decide your lifestyle should change, your beliefs will change with it. There's nothing you can anchor yourself to. You got to do the word of God. You got to live it. So what does it produce then? The cool thing is James always leaves us with something, right? So he kind of gives us something this produces. And so here's what your life looks like when you hear his word, you accept his word, and then you actually do it. You actually live it. So there's kind of three things that he gives us as evidence of God working in your life, of his word in your life. First thing is this, is you find control of your tongue. It's pretty interesting. So if you claim to be religious, you don't control your tongue, you're fooling yourself and your religion is worthless. Like that's kind of where he starts with the whole be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger. is this saying that I've heard a few times recently, and it's really kind of made me think. It says, as Christians, we've forgotten how to blush. Have you realized that in your own life? Like, we've forgotten how to blush. And what that means is, like, when we're going through our day and something happens that used to make us go, whoa, right? Like, we don't even notice it anymore. So, like, we used to watch TV, and, like, if any skin was showing, it was like, we got to turn that, right? Like, when I grew up in my house, that's the way it was with my parents. Or you heard a dirty joke, you immediately walked away. You didn't laugh at it. And now it doesn't make us blush anymore. And now we've gotten to the place where sometimes, to be honest with you, we have the foulest mouths in the workplace. We get hot-tempered. We get angry. We scream. We cuss. We tear people down. Like, my least favorite, I think, saying of all is, I'm just being honest. Has anyone just been honest and crushed you with their words before, with their honesty? Have you ever done that to somebody? Like, I'm just being honest. That's my excuse now to totally destroy you with my words. Just being honest. Just being honest. It doesn't need to be said, but I want to be honest, so I'm just going to say it, and I'm going to destroy you with what I'm saying to you. Letting the word into your life has an effect on your tongue. It directs the way you speak to people and how you speak and the things that you speak. So we no longer speak out of anger, and we no longer speak out of, you know, just vitriol, right? We also don't speak filth. It always amazes me, the guy who I know goes to church, I know he reads his Bible, he even brings his Bible to work with him sometimes, and he's the one in there telling the dirty jokes. Control your tongue. That's what having the word in your life does. It helps you to control your tongue. And if you can't control your tongue, then actually your religion is worthless, James says. It's pretty tough, I know. That's what it says. The second thing is this, is it's about placing others first. He then says, pure and genuine religion in the sight of God the Father means caring for orphans and widows in their distress. Who is number one in your life? Are you number one in your life? Or do you put others first in your life? The Bible's pretty clear. Placing others first. And the third thing is this. It is purity or holiness. Then he finishes up by saying, and refusing to let the world corrupt you. There's a holiness. There's a purity that should be a part of our lives when you follow Christ. When you get the word into your life, it produces holiness. It produces purity. Instead of believing according to our lifestyle, our lifestyle is dictated by our beliefs. Peter says it this way. He said, God the Father knew you and chose you long ago, and his Spirit has made you holy. As a result, you have obeyed him and have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. See, it's that holiness that you receive that he gives you that actually allows you to obey, and it's the obedience that brings you holiness. It's kind of this cycle that starts to happen. And lastly, Ezekiel says it this way. Here's why we need holiness in our lives. It says, when I reveal my holiness through you before their very eyes, talking about this world, says the Sovereign Lord, then the nations will know that I am the Lord. You see, everywhere you go, you are representative of Christ. You bear his name. If you call yourself a Christian, you bear his name. So everywhere you go, you're his representative. And so the words that you speak, the way that you treat others, the way that you behave, all of that reflects back on him. And his plan all along was to reveal himself to the nations through you and through me, through us. And so purity and holiness is needed. These are the things that are, I guess they're evidence that God's working in your life. And so step back, take a look in the mirror, and say, am I living the kind of life that God has called me to live? Am I living holy and pure? Am I listening to his word? Am I accepting what it is that he has to say to us? Am I doing what it's asking me to do? And as a result, am I a better person for it? Am I taking care of others? Have I got control of my tongue? Am I living a holy and pure life that shows the nations that Jesus Christ is Lord? James is a hard-hitting book, and it's not always easy, but this is the life that God requires of us out there. It's because out there it's not safe like it is in here. And so when we're out there, we have to have something to anchor ourselves to, and that thing is the word of God. You got to get it in your life. Let's pray. Father, I just thank you so much for your word today. I thank you that James penned these words 2,000 years ago. They have so much deep meaning to us here, even today. And so, Lord, today our prayer is that you would help us to live your word. That every chance we get, we would get into your word, to know your word, so that it can make a difference in our lives, so that you can bless us. It's not a safe world. It's a tough world to live in. It's only by your word that we can make it through, God. So today, help us to be people of your word. Help us to be pure and holy. Keep control of our tongues. And to put others first. We pray these things in your name. Amen. Amen.